Good afternoon, friends. It's just noon. So, my friends tell me that I'm a good storyteller. Probably that is the reason why I've been invited for this TED Talk. To tell you the story of a very dear friend whom I have seen from early childhood days, as we were very close buddies. We used to call him a person from a species from a different world altogether. And you know why? Because he started showing the signs of being a rebel, questioning the status quo, doing everything that only what he got the right answers for. So he believed and did only those things that he got the right answers for. Before schooling, as his mother narrates, he used to stand on the street with a stick in his hand. This is at very early days. He used to stand on the street with a stick in his hand, trying to control the vehicles and the cyclists as his friends, they played on the street. So people then predicted that this guy would become the traffic police head. Now, when he went to school, he was the one who was always looking out of the window. So what he got was the class monitor position and the front bench right under the nose of the teacher so that he couldn't look here and there. But this mad guy, he always preferred the middle bench so that he could enjoy both the worlds. Parents, his questions would put parents and teachers both in trouble as they had to, you know, work really hard to get the right answers for him because he would not get convinced so easily. So people then predicted this guy would become a teacher. After school, while his friends took regular medical and engineering, this guy rebelled again. And he chose a very emerging field then, computers. Now, people did not predict anything now because they didn't know anything about it, right? But this guy, he very smartly rode the IT wave and he went from cities to countries, getting responsibilities first of cities, then of states, then nationally, and finally leading 10 countries. His salary multiplied many, many times. He couldn't even believe. But then after 15 years, when he was at the hem of his career, the rebel in him surfaced again. Now this guy, he used to get those, you know, kind of fits every 15 years. So after 15 years, the rebel again came out. And he started searching for something more meaningful in his life. He often wondered, how are we different from animals? As they also feed their families, so do we. The difference is only in our ways of hunting or getting food. So the search of being more than an animal took him to a sector which people generally know as the social sector, of which he had no experience or exposure. And then suddenly, with a family of five dependents on his head, this guy leaves his international job and career. People then call him an absolute mad, and they did not dare predict anything about him now. But this mad guy was headstrong. As he jumped into the social sector, trying to find a space where he can add some value. He did not want to do the regular things, so he wanted to add some value to it. 1.5 years of search and research went by, brought him to nothing, as the family managed somehow on his savings. The coffer was draining and the clock was ticking. As this guy started comparing his social sector efforts with his corporate experience. And then suddenly, like a light bulb, something clicked. He found that while every industry in the world has got research laboratories where new products and processes are developed, social sector being such a big industry did not have any. What the research was being done here in the social sector was primarily data collection, analysis, report writing, some impacting policy, some getting published, rest getting dumped. Now he thought, society is continuously changing. Community needs are growing. People's aspirations are evolving. How long could old approaches work in this dynamic environment? But where was the space, the lab, to develop new approaches. This guy had found his space in the sector. So he brought a few like-minded people together and unleashed his madness. And what they did was, they started a social innovations laboratory. Now, during those days, the social sector was receiving a lot of flack, primarily because of pilferage of government funds in collaboration with them. Now, this guy set down his own rules. No government funds, and not party to any corruption, small or big, period. The veterans in the sector, they literally laughed at him. And they said, ah, the new kid in the neighborhood, he'll be there for a while. 2 years of hard toil, this guy ran pillar to post, identifying problems, finding new practical solutions, discussing with others, and becoming a mockery of all. But all that could not put him down. Instead, it made him visible in the international arena. And suddenly, things changed when this guy received an international fellowship and recognition from a leading social entrepreneurship organization and became an Ashoka Fellow. Funding organizations now started approaching him so that they could help him test his ideas on the ground. And this guy, he went berserk. Now this is my time. Year after year, he started churning out innovative approaches to address long-standing social, environmental, economic problems and issues. His piloted approaches started being adopted and replicated by governments, NGOs, universities, corporates. And this mad guy never asked for any royalty or credits. He was happy with his fellowship stipend. But the family being sustained, now his wife joined him too. While all this was happening, many aspiring social entrepreneurs sought his advice and became successful. These social entrepreneurs, when they were mentored by his lab, when they credited this guy for their success, he felt very humbled. Not me, you know. Some of them even had international acclaim, like Forbes 30 under 30. Now, our mad guy felt very humbled. Suddenly, a suggestion from the World Bank Development Marketplace officials. They suggested that why don't you replicate your social innovations lab? Because that's a model too. And he started doing that internationally through universities, supporting social entrepreneurs from ideation to institution. Now, 15 years again went by in this madness. Till one day, again, the 15-year cycle. Till one day, someone just asked him, what impact have you made? Now, when that guy did not receive any response, he said, why don't you search the internet and find out who all have replicated your approaches, where, and impacted how many lives? Now, this guy, his eyes popped out as he and his team started searching the internet, because the figures popped out in multiple digits. Overwhelmed and shocked by the numbers, he held his wife's hands one day and said, hey, we did it. Look at the figures, aren't these amazing? His wife says, yes, they are. But I know you're too modest enough to take credit of all this. So let me take charge. She then used all her capabilities to put it gradually on different media platforms and got the rest of the international awards, including the UNESCO's Asia Pacific Award. But this offer of her and the expert handling of things put this guy again into deep thoughts, and he started contemplating again. Finally, after months of introspection, he planned his next steps. He decided to let go of the reins before the publicity brought him any ego. The decision was difficult for the team. It was tough. But everyone knew his strong-headed madness. When asked what would he do next, he said, look, I've taken enough from family, from society, from nature. I've given back to my family. I've given back to society. Now it's time to give back to nature. It took over a year to transfer his organization to the second team. Now this guy's never say, never again instinct is now taking him to a deforested area where he plans to develop a fruit forest and leave it to the wild to enjoy. Mad guy. He wants to spend the rest of his life in this mission and repay back to nature. Now one day, a journalist, she asked him, which part of life did you enjoy the most? The corporate one or the social one? Without the blink of an eye, this guy said, of course the social one. This was the period when I actually realized my entire potential and made the most out of my life. When she asked, how did you manage without money? He said, well, I realized that society had instilled in me a fear which was completely baseless. How much money did my family require to sustain? I was unnecessarily pushed into this mad rush. My family lived happily with less money than it did earlier. Now, the journalist could not take it much. She was not convinced. The next question she was, how did the family take it? So this guy, he answered with a naughty smile and he said, you know what? My parents and my extended family had already given up on me. So they did not have any expectations. My wife was my biggest support. And we just did things the way we wanted to, with the right intent. We did not run after money. Money came in on its own whenever it was required. We just continued our work and things happened. The journalist was not yet convinced. She could not swallow the whole thing. She asked, how did you remove your fear? To which this guy answers, you know what? I first did away with all my life insurances. My goodness. Then what? So he says, for me, equipping my family members to become financially independent was the best insurance. So when there was no life insurance, there was no option left except to stand on your feet. So this journalist had enough. And then she said, well, what is it that you want to do now in future? He said, well, that's a $1 million question. I don't know what I'm going to do, and I don't want to divulge the details, because he was getting to know that this journalist was, you know, she was uncomfortable. So he said, look, now that I have made my family capable enough, my kids are also capable. And you know what happened, that when my kids grew up, I just give them two choices. Either become a job beggar or become a job giver. My children chose the latter. And they did well. So they have their own initiatives now. They are growing strong. They are becoming financially independent. They're on their feet. I have nothing more to give to my family and society. So I'm now going to give back to nature. The journalist asked, what are you going to do? Where nature? He said, well, you know, I'm going to the forest. The journalist ran away, never published this interview. But then, just before going, she gathered her whole courage to ask the last question. She said, okay, before I leave, tell me, how do you find a solution to every problem? So this guy said, you've kept the best for the last, okay. He said, look, if you have identified something as a problem, you definitely have thought of a solution which is in your mind. Otherwise, it would have been your way of life. The difference is only in keeping the solution just in your mind or testing it on the ground. Now the journalist could not stand anymore. She ran away. Now, completely indifferent to all societal norms and expectations, this guy proved that living away from the mad rush is more fulfilling and satisfying, healthy and happy. It helped him use his only life, not for 4 people on this earth, but for 4 million. Just by choosing the second approach, he has been able to change many lives and probably ignite some minds too. But the first courageous step to it was overcoming the fear that society instills in us. The goal, therefore, should not be to have much, but to decide how much. On seeing his approach work, now some young professionals are taking his route, leaving their corporate careers and trying to live a similar life full of exciting madness. God bless them. With more salt than pepper on his head now, this guy nurtures still the heart of a child, gets excited at every new thing. And if he believes and follows George Bernard Shaw's quote, it says, "You see things and you say why. I dream things that never were and ask why not." So this was the story of a mad guy. I hope you liked it. But do you want to meet him? Want to meet him? It's me. Thank you.